If we want to talk about how to do calculus for multivariable functions, sooner or later we have to ask the question, what does it mean to take derivatives of multivariable functions? How do we do it? Now, the good news is we know how to take derivatives of single variable functions, so perhaps we can build off of that idea. And spoiler alert, we will. Let's get into it. So, how can we think about taking derivatives? Well, one thing we can do is called reducing to a problem you've previously solved. This is a great tool in mathematics. It says, hey, if I've solved a problem before, let me try to understand how to take that solution and solve it somewhere else. In other words, we like to recycle. See, mathematicians, we're good for the environment. So what do we have? Well, suppose we have a surface. So here we have a surface. Z is a function, f of x, y. And we're trying to understand what's happening here. So when we look at this surface, we of course see this whole various thing sitting here, some sort of bubble, part of a bubble here. Of course, that's just a piece of it. But what we can do is say, look, the problem is we have two variables. How do we get down to one variable? So what we can do is slice. Doom, slice. So what you see here is that we've taken a slice of our function. And so now what do we see? Well, here, x is a fixed value. So we've sliced for a fixed value of x. And as a consequence, now what we see in just slice is we see a curve. So in other words, this piece of the surface becomes a curve. Now we're like, wow, we know how to take derivatives of that curve because that's single variable calculus. And so we say, okay, great. So what we'll do as we start going down the road for derivatives is we'll say, what can we say about the derivatives in the slices? And you're probably thinking, okay, cool, but how do we still take derivatives of the function? And I'm just going to go ahead and tell you now, this is how we take derivatives. We're always going to work in slices. All right, so let's get a little bit more precise about what we mean here. So what do we mean when we say we're working in that slice? So this is holding x fixed. So what we can think of is saying we have a new curve, and it depends only on y, because x is fixed. So you can say that there's this function called g of y, which is f of xy. What's the derivative? Well, we just talk about the definition. We can say, look, g prime of y, there's a definition, it is what it is, and we have a name. So what we call it is we're saying, look, this is, how does the function change as we change our input in the y entry? That's what we're really looking at. So we're saying, okay, we're holding our x value fixed and saying, what happens as we vary y? So we're going to call that the derivative of f with respect to y, or partial f, partial y. All right. So that's what we call it, the partial derivative. Now, the reason we call it the partial derivative is, of course, there are multiple variables involved. So we're only looking at one part. So that's where the partial comes from. So these are going to be our derivatives. Now, if we think about it, there's lots of ways you can slice, of course, many different ways, but there's two natural ways to slice. One of them you can think of where you hold, say, the x fixed, or the other one where you hold the y fixed. So we can go through and repeat the same argument. If we hold y fixed, then again, I'm in a slice. Everything depends on x in that slice. So I say take the derivative. And what am I looking at? I'm saying, how does the function change as we change the x-coordinate? So we call that the partial derivative of f with respect to x. How much is f changing as the x-input changes? All right, good. So actually, partial derivatives aren't so bad. They're actually pretty straightforward. So the rule of thumb is when you're taking a partial derivative, you say, look, what am I taking the derivative with respect to? Whatever I'm taking the derivative with respect to, that's the part that can vary. Anything else is not varying. Treat it like a constant. So this means if I have some variable that only shows up once or twice, I'm taking derivative with respect to that variable, it's not so bad. Even if the other variable looks terrible. So, okay, just remember, what derivative am I taking it with respect to? What's the variable? And that'll help make things pretty simple. We talked about two variables. Of course, this works for functions of three variables, four variables, 17 variables. Doesn't matter. Same principle applies. You only take the derivative with respect to one variable at a time. All right, pause for a moment here. I want to talk about notation. Because you might have noticed we started using this partial. So what does that mean? Well, it's just another way to write notation. So in some sense, you could say, we're used to using the d symbol. We're talking about a derivative. We had a function of one variable. And we're going to be consistent with our notation. So whenever you see a d showing up for derivative, that means that the derivative that we're taking is a function of only one variable. And so what do we say? Well, we say df dx, or f prime of x. So now we have this new symbol. Now, we should talk about this new symbol. You'll see it in a couple of different contexts. So this is the symbol partial. The way you write it is like this. So it's almost like you're writing a very big fancy two, but you don't cross through. So you can practice. I'll mark some little arrows here just so you can follow along. And you say, okay, so that's our symbol here, the partial symbol. Whenever you see that, again, derivative. So both the d and the partial represent derivative. The difference is, what kind of function do you have? So d is for single variable, partial is for two or more. And so you read it out, partial f partial x, or partial f partial y, or whatever your variables happen to be called. There's nothing special about x and y. That just happens to be convenient names that we've grown used to after a few hundred years. But we can call them whatever name we want. Now, you'll notice something. Before we said, oh, that's f prime. Now, we can't use f prime of x, y. Well, what's wrong? Well, if you think about f prime of x, y, it says, hey, you took a derivative. Okay, which one? You see, it doesn't have enough information. When we only have one variable and we say, hey, you took a derivative. All right, well, I must have taken with respect to the only variable I had available to me. But here, there's more than one variable. So it's not so clear. So that's why we don't use this notation. So we're not going to use our f prime. Instead, we're going to have another notation that keeps track of what variable we're talking about. So we use that by doing subscripts. So when I'm taking the derivative with respect to x, we use a subscript f sub x, or derivative with respect to y, f sub y. So when you start seeing those subscripts, those are indicating that you had partial derivatives. And what kind of partial derivatives you had. Now you might say, great, okay, so that's one. Can we take more? Can we take many? Sure, we can do that. We can take as many partial derivatives as we want. No problem. So let's talk about them. So let's look at, say, the second order. These will be important as we go later on. Of course, you can do as high as you want. But what do you have? Well, you have several possibilities. See, when there's only one variable, there's just one second derivative. Now, if there's two variables, there's actually four. Because you have two derivatives, and in each choice, you have one of two options. So that's why two times two gives you four. So what are some notations? Well, sometimes you'll write it in this format. Partial squared f partial x squared really says, look, take the derivative with respect to x. That's what this partial x means. It's the derivative function. It says, hey, whatever you plug into me, take the derivative with respect to this symbol. So they're taking the derivative with respect to x. So it says, take the derivative of the first derivative. And we denote it fxx. You have partial squared f partial x partial y, which means take the derivative with respect to x of the derivative with respect to y, and notation, that's fyx. And partial squared f partial y partial x derivative with respect to y derivative of f with respect to x, f x y. And second derivative of f with respect to y, or partial squared f, partial y squared, is f y y. Now you might ask the question, are these distinct? Well, that's a great question. And generally speaking, the fxx, fyy, yeah, those are can be very, very different. It turns out that you have some nice things happen, namely that we call these mixed partial derivatives are equal for nice functions. Now you might say, well, great, what's a nice function, Steve? Well, one where they're equal, right? No. When we talk about a nice function, it's one where you can take lots and lots of derivatives. In other words, pretty much everything that we've encountered is a nice function. Now, there are sort of extreme examples where you can say, aha, I can create a function where it doesn't match up at a particular point. But if you dig into it a little bit, what you see is, well, yeah, the problem is that you can't take arbitrarily many derivatives around that point. Things start to sort of break down. So as long as you're dealing with the kind of functions where you can write down, you can, for our purposes, say, hey, f sub xy, f sub yx, they're equal. So we'll just assume that they're equal. We'll actually do some examples in the practice. We'll work through some, and we'll say, oh, they match. Cool. But beyond that, pretty much these will all be distinct, which means you really have to put in some work. Well, of course, you can imagine we've done two derivatives. How about three or four? Of course, you can do more. So what can you do? Well, here's an example of a fifth derivative. Now, how do I know it's a fifth derivative? Well, I can see it's a fifth derivative because of this exponent here, partial 5. That means it's a fifth derivative. And now, what derivatives did I take? Well, derivative of x, derivative of y, derivative of z twice. Now, there's sort of this sort of interesting notational thing going on where you'll notice if you look at the orders on the left-hand side here, you have x, z, y, z, z. The way we apply things is we actually apply them sort of in that direction. So it says first take derivative with respect to z, and then y, and then z, and then x. On the other hand, in the subscript notation, it's the other direction. So they kind of like go in opposite orders. Z, z, y, z, x. And so should you worry about that? No. Because again, as long as you're working with nice functions, it doesn't matter which order you take derivatives as long as you take them all. Now you might say, z, z, y, z, x. Is that a word? Yes, it actually is a word. Zizix. And you're probably thinking, no, you made that up. But it's actually, there's a road that's on the highway from Los Angeles to Las Vegas called Zizix Road. And they even made a movie called Zizix, and it made 30 at the box office. You're like, wow, 30 million, that's not bad. No. 30, just $30 total. It was not a very good movie. Of course, nobody knows, nobody saw it. But that's about the only word I know of that you can spell with only the letters Z, Y, and X. One other thing before we leave this. We don't spend a lot of time talking about notation when it comes to things like units. And because that's like a physics concern. But I just want to point out, if you want to know what your units are for any partial derivative, it's actually pretty straightforward. Here's what you do. So suppose I wanted to know the units, say, for this expression here. What happens? Well, you look upstairs, you say, okay, I have f, so I'm going to have the units of f once. Then downstairs, I have an x, one time, so that's units of x downstairs once. I have a y one time, so units of y downstairs once. And I have z and z squared. That makes a total of 3 z's, so that'll be the units of z 3 times. In other words, units work really great if you follow this notation. Okay, f is there once, x is there once, y is there once, and z is there 3 times. And it works out beautifully. One last small detail. So now that we've talked about partial derivatives, we can mention something called partial differential equations. Now, these are an incredibly important topic because, well, what are differential equations? Well, they're saying, hey, I'm trying to understand how things change, and I have a nice relationship between how things change and what the current situation is. Can I figure out what my actual function is? Because in physics, it's surprisingly easy to say, oh, there is this nice relationship. And now we say, well, wait, what if I have many things changing? And I can talk about many types of change going on simultaneously. Well, that's partial derivatives. And so we are interested in saying, suppose I have a relationship where I have these various partial derivatives are connected together. Can I figure out what the original function was? And that is an incredibly fascinating and an incredibly challenging topic, and one that far exceeds our scope. There's literally, you can spend years and years studying this, and you still won't know everything. But there is some good news. Actually solving them is tough, but verifying is easy. So you might see a problem that says, verify that such and such a function satisfies a particular differential equation. What does that mean? It says, well, just carry out the various derivatives involved, plug them in, and see, is it true? And if it is, then that's a verification that you have a solution. Here are some examples of things that show up. There's the Laplace equation, which says uxx plus uyy equals zero. There's the heat equation, and here, well, you have three variables, right? The t, the x, the y. U sub t, think of that as time, as some multiple of uxx plus uyy. It's not so far from the Laplace equation. Those are just two. There's many, many more. Lots and lots of things to learn and do. Well, I think this is a great time for us to go and do some practice. So, hope to see you soon.